As we continue our series on making a case for the inspiration of the Scriptures, we want to start part four and focus on the historical and archaeological evidence that supports the scriptural story. And so far on this roadmap of apologetics or of evidences that we've been on, we've looked at, is the Bible textually accurate and reliable? And we've concluded that all the evidence says that it is, that we have the same text that was originally written, of course, in our own language today. We've talked about, is it prophetically accurate? And we've shown several examples of how the Old Testament writers were able to accurately prophesy about something that history shows really did take place. And how could they do that without being inspired? We talked in part three about science, the abundant evidence that shows that God really is the creator of the universe and the creator of life, and that science actually supports that creation story as opposed to the Big Bang or evolution or some of those other theories that are purported in our society. In this part, we want to focus on historical writings, and we want to focus on discoveries in archaeology that I think are fascinating when we look at the Bible and whether or not the Bible is accurate geographically, whether it's accurately in names and in places and all of those things that it mentions throughout history. And I think the Bible claims that it is that way. In fact, Romans 15 and verse 4 says, whatsoever things were written aforetime were written for our learning, that we through patience and comfort of the Scriptures might have hope. We're supposed to be able to look at the Old Testament, and we're supposed to learn from the Old Testament. And if the Old Testament's full of just fairy tales and stories and made-up places and made-up people, then how are we really supposed to learn? How is that really knowledge that's going to help us? But the fact is, the Bible teaches those things are true, and history supports that record. And I hope that we'll see that throughout this study. There was an article written in 2002, published by Harper's Magazine, written by a man named Daniel Lazar. And this article was entitled, False Testament, Archaeology Refutes the Bible's Claim to History. And I want to read an excerpt of that article where Mr. Lazar says, in the last quarter century or so, archaeologists have seen one settled assumption after another concerning who the ancient Israelites were and where they came from proved false. Rather than a band of invaders who fought their way into the Holy Land, the Israelites are now thought to have been an indigenous culture that developed west of the Jordan River around 1200 BC. Abraham, Isaac, and the other patriarchs appear to have been spliced together out of various pieces of local lore. The Davidic Empire, which archaeologists once thought as incontrovertible as the Roman, is now seen as an invention of Jerusalem-based priests in the 7th and 8th centuries BC, who were eager to burnish their national history. So Mr. Lazar is making a statement that the Old Testament stories, specifically those regarding the kingdom of Israel, the kingdom of David, the patriarchs, all of that, that none of that's true. In fact, that the Israelites were just an indigenous culture. They pieced together out of other cultures' histories, the patriarch stories like Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And that in the 7th or 8th century BCs, Jerusalem-based priests concocted the idea of this great King David and the nation of Israel, and that David ruled and all of that, and that all of that was just made up. And he says, archaeology is what has showed us this. Archaeology is what has proved this. And I hope that through the course of this presentation, you'll see that that is absolutely not true. And that in fact, archaeology does nothing except support the biblical story and historical record that lies within it. And I want to share with you a few archaeological discoveries. We obviously cannot talk about all of them. In part two, we talked a little bit about the Dead Sea Scrolls and the importance of that discovery. But I want to use a few different examples here in this presentation about some archaeological discoveries that really, really are key to understanding the truth that the Bible has within it. So the Ebla tablets, you can see up on the screen, these little tablets. There are about 17,000 of these small tablets found in northern Syria, and this comes from the ancient kingdom of Ebla. These were discovered in 1975. And the Sumerian and Eblaic languages used on these tablets share many names with the biblical text. Names that are found in these tablets include Abram, David, Esau, Ishmael, Israel, Michael, and Saul. That's not to say that the specific people recorded in the Bible are the same people mentioned in these tablets, but these tablets come from that same general time frame when these patriarchs would have lived. And so to show from history and archaeology that these were the names from that time frame matters. Because if all of that was made up 1,000 years later, the common names would have been different 1,000 years later. But instead, the common names are the common names. There is also common city names like Salem, Hazor, Lachish, Gaza, Sinai, Ashtaroth, Joppa, and Damascus. All of these cities are mentioned in these Ebla tablets. And in fact, there's a specific passage in Genesis chapter 14 and verse 8, which lists an alliance of five kings. And it says in verse 8, there went out the king of Sodom, the king of Gomorrah, the king of Admah, the king of Zeboam, and the king of Bela, the same as Zoar. And those five kings or five kingdoms are also represented in these tablets. And they are listed in the same order as they are listed in Scripture. Apparently, these five cities worked together sort of as an alliance, often enough that not only did the Bible record them that way, but this Eblaic people also recorded them in the same way. So these tablets, Ebla tablets, provide us some common names, city names, people names, and a very fascinating look at an exact replica, basically, of the way the Scripture describes these five kings or cities. Dr. Clifford Wilson holds a PhD in psycholinguistics. He says, it is at least thought-provoking that findings such as those at Ebla consistently support the Bible as a thoroughly acceptable record. And even those outside of God or outside of Christianity recognize the importance that these archaeological discoveries have. There's another discovery that hopefully that you'll find very fascinating. This is an important one because this discovery was the first piece of archaeology that contained the phrase, the king of the house of David, or house of David, or kingdom of David. Before this point, there had been no record in the record of archaeology of that phrase or of that name. And many skeptics of the Bible said, see, David was just made up. There's no record of it in history or archaeology of the kingdom of David or the house of David actually existing. But this is called the Tel Dan Stele. And what a stele is, it's an upright monument that commemorates a victory. A lot of times a king or a kingdom that wins a battle might put a stone monument there and inscribe details of the victory. That's what a stele is. And so this was an Armenian king who was celebrating the victory over his two southern neighbors. And guess who his two southern neighbors were? The king of Israel and the king of the house of David. Now, it's interesting, you know, from biblical history that the kingdom split, right? Jeroboam and Rehoboam. And suddenly you had two kingdoms, the kingdom of Judah, which was David's kingdom, which contained those two tribes, and the 10 tribes of the north referred to as the house or the kingdom of Israel. And so this Armenian king records a victory over his two southern neighbors, the king of Israel and the king of the house of David, exactly as the Old Testament describes these kingdoms. Dr. Eric Klein holds a PhD in ancient history, says, today, after much further discussion in academic journals, it is accepted by most archaeologists that the inscription is not only genuine, but that the reference is indeed to the house of David, thus representing the first textual evidence found anywhere outside the Bible for the biblical David. So the Tel Dan Stele is a very important discovery when it comes to looking at Old Testament history, specifically the kingdom of David, and recognizing that it was not just a made-up story, but it exists outside of the Bible as well. Now that discovery actually allowed that phrase, the house of David, to be translated on another piece of archaeology. And this stone that you see on the screen is called the Mesha Stele. Sometimes it's referred to as the Moabite stone. Now this stele, once again, is an upright monument that commemorates a victory. This was discovered in 1868 in Dabon, Jordan, about 20 miles east of the Dead Sea, and it records the revolt of Mesha, who was king of Moab, when he revolted or rebelled against Israel. Now what's fascinating about this is we actually have this story in Scripture as well. So we can look at Old Testament Scripture, and we can look at this piece of archaeology, and we can see some pretty fascinating similarities. The first line on this stele says, I am Mesha, son of Chemosh-Yadi, the king of Moab, the Dibonite, or Dibonite. Now, Chemosh was their deity, and so that's their god. And so Mesha is the king, and he's saying, I'm Mesha, the son of Chemosh, their deity, the king of Moab. In 2 Kings 3, 4, and 5, we have record of a king named Mesha of Moab, who was a sheep master, same guy. So we look kind of forward into the lines of the story, and we can't, as you can see in this picture, a large portion of this stele is there. And so there's a lot of lines, so we can't read all of it. I want to share a few lines that I think are very interesting. Lines 4 through 7 on this stele, Mesha records, he says, as for Omri, the king of Israel, you recognize that name? King Omri is found in Scripture as well. He says, as for Omri, the king of Israel, he humbled Moab for many years or days, for Chemosh was angry with his land, and his son reigned in his place. And he also said, I will oppress Moab. In my days, he said so. Now, who was Omri? 1 Kings 16:29 says, in the 38th year of Asa, king of Judah, began Ahab, the son of Omri, to reign over Israel. And Ahab, the son of Omri, reigned over Israel and Samaria 22 years. You may be more familiar with Ahab. Ahab married Jezebel. Ahab was the vilest and most wicked king that had ever lived up to his point. Omri was his father. So you've got Omri and you've got Ahab mentioned in scripture. Well, on this stele, which commemorates a victory against an opponent, you've got this Moabite king saying, I fought against, or really he says, I was oppressed by both Omri and his son. And he doesn't name Ahab by name, but he says his son. We know from scripture that would be Ahab. Line 17 and 18 from this stele, he says, and from there I took the vessels of Yahweh and I presented them before the face of Chemosh. Now I want to show you this because, you know, Chemosh is their god. The scripture actually records this as well. In Judges 11 verse 24, the scripture says, will not thou possess that which Chemosh thy god giveth thee to possess? So the similarity between these two, between the scriptures and between this piece of archaeology is fascinating. This isn't Christian. This has nothing to do with God. This is a totally different kingdom, a totally different culture, a totally different civilization who's recording an interaction with King Omri, with King Ahab, being oppressed by them, talking about Chemosh. The Bible talks about Chemosh of the Moabites. The Moabites also mentions Yahweh, which, as you know, was the Hebrew name for Jehovah God, right? And so on this stone, you've got the name Yahweh represented as well. Line 31 says, and the house of David dwelt in Haran. And now the house of David there was able to be translated because of the previous stele. We talked about the tail down stele. So now there are two ancient stone monuments that have that phrase house of David on it that date before those 7th century BC priests supposedly concocted this story about King David. Line 7, he gets into some details about the battle that he supposedly fought. And this is where it's interesting because a stele is commemorating a victory, right? Well, the story that's on the stele is slightly different than the story that's in scripture. And I want to show you, I think you'll find it interesting. Verse 7, or line 7, he says, but I triumphed over him and over his house, and Israel has perished. Now that didn't happen, according to scripture. Israel didn't perish, but what King Misha actually is doing is he's embellishing a little bit with the story. Lines 14 through 16 says, and Chemosh said to me, go take Nebo from Israel. And I went in the night and fought against it from the daybreak until midday. And I took it and I killed the whole population. See, what Misha did was he won some battles. He went to some specific cities, fought against Israel, and destroyed them and obliterated them. Those cities, not the kingdom itself, not the whole people, not the whole population. 2 Kings 3 verse 5 records it this way, but it came to pass when Ahab was dead that the king of Moab rebelled against the king of Israel. And then goes on to kind of describe the battles there. Verse 24 says, when they came to the camp of Israel, the Israelites rose up and smote the Moabites so that they fled before them, but they went forward smiting the Moabites even in their country. So according to scripture, King Misha leads the Moabites in a rebellion against Israel and drives them all the way basically to where the Israelites are camped, and then the Israelites are able to fight back and to push them back, even back into their own country. And then the war or the battle, the rebellion ends this way. Verse 26, when the king of Moab saw that the battle was too sore for him, he took with him 700 men that drew swords to break through even into the king of Edom, but they could not. Then he took his eldest son that should have reigned in his stead and offered him for a burnt offering upon the wall. And there was great indignation against Israel, and they departed from him and returned to their own land. So think about the scriptural story, and then think about why Misha would be able to create this stele commemorating a great victory over Israel. The Israelites fight back against this rebellion, push the Moabites back into their hometown, and are about to beat them. And in a last-ditch effort, Misha takes his oldest son, who should be the next king, and he sacrifices him in front of all of Israel. Israel is so disturbed and disgusted by this act that they leave and go back home and leave the Moabites be. And so at that point, though it took the offering of his son, you can see from Misha's standpoint how he would believe that this was a great victory. The Israelites have now backed off, they've left him alone, and he is free, quote unquote. And so he creates this stele and commemorates this great victory against Israel and against David. When in fact, it wasn't really that much of a victory, but from his standpoint, his rebellion accomplished something. And it got the Israelites to back off and allow them to have freedom in their own land. So even though the stories are slightly different, really they're not. Really, you can see it from both perspectives and see why Misha would consider this a victory and why also Israel could consider this a victory. Kyle Boot, speaker, writer, and editor for Apologetics Press, says, "Taken as a whole, the Moabite stone remains one of the most impressive pieces of evidence verifying the historical accuracy of the Old Testament. And although this find has been around almost 150 years, it still speaks to us today." I want to share with you another discovery that I think this one is fascinating, because for years, critics of the Bible took a story out of Daniel chapter 5 of a man named Belshazzar. And they said, the Bible's not true and it makes stuff up because Belshazzar is not a real guy. In fact, though the scripture calls Belshazzar king of Babylon and even says his father is Nebuchadnezzar, that's not true. In fact, history records otherwise. And so for years, skeptics were able to say, see, this is an example of where the Bible just makes stuff up and it's not true. Let me read Daniel chapter 5, the first couple of verses. It says, "Belshazzar the king made a great feast to 1,000 of his lords and drank wine before the 1,000. Belshazzar, whilst he tasted the wine, commanded to bring the golden and silver vessels, which his father Nebuchadnezzar had taken out of the temple, which was in Jerusalem, that the king and his princes, his wives, his concubines might drink therein." Now, if you remember this story, eventually what happens is, this is the story of the handwriting on the wall. Belshazzar sees that hand write something. He can't read what's written. He searches around for somebody that can interpret. Daniel's the guy that's able to interpret. And basically it says something along the lines of, you've been weighed, you've been measured, you've been found lacking, you're going to be destroyed tonight. And that's exactly what happens. In fact, we see that destruction happened in the last couple of verses of Daniel chapter 5. It says, "In that night was Belshazzar, the king of the Chaldeans, slain, and Darius the Median took the kingdom, being about 62 years old." And so we have recorded here, this is a succession of kingship. You might remember in Daniel 2, Daniel prophesied that succession after Babylon, that the Medes and the Persians would rule. We see that happen in Daniel 5. So Belshazzar, the king, is being taken out by Darius the Median. And so Belshazzar is now dead. Well, did Belshazzar actually exist? Here's what history says. This comes from Berosus, who is a 3rd century Babylonian writer. This is also confirmed by some other king lists that exist. But this lists the last 5 Babylonian kings. And they are as follows. Nebuchadnezzar, who we're very familiar with from scripture. Then Nebuchadnezzar's son rules after him for a couple of years. Then there's 2 other guys that rule, very short reigns. And then there's a man by the name of Nabonidus, who rules for about 17 years. And it's at the end of Nabonidus' reign that history records that the Medes and the Persians then take over and Babylon is overthrown. So history says Nabonidus was the last king. The Bible says Belshazzar was the last king. Well, obvious contradiction and problem, right? Except that's where archaeology steps in. Some cylinders, as you see up there on the right, were discovered. And then this also, what's called the Nabonidus Chronicle here on the bottom, was discovered, that actually changed completely the way that historians and archaeologists had to look at this story. 4 identical clay cylinders were discovered in 1854 at the base of a ziggurat, or basically a temple in Ur. Another cylinder with a different inscription was discovered in 1881 near Babylon. These are called the Nabonidus cylinders. This is the Nabonidus Chronicle, acquired in 1879. And both of these artifacts together prove that King Nabonidus, who was that last king of Babylon, that history says was the last king, King Nabonidus had a son named Belshazzar, and that Belshazzar ruled alongside him in a co-regency. And I'm going to show you how these prove exactly what the Bible stated to be true. Here's a line off of one of these cylinders. It says, "As for me, Nabonidus, king of Babylon," remember, according to history, last Babylonian king, "save me from sinning against your great Godhead and grant me as a present a life long of days. And as for Belshazzar, the eldest son, my offspring, instill reverence for your great Godhead in his heart, and may he not commit any cultic mistake. May he be sated with a life of plenitude." So suddenly there's a piece of archaeology that now says Belshazzar exists. He was the son of Nabonidus, okay? Now remember though, Daniel 5 said Belshazzar was the son of Nebuchadnezzar his father, right? So there's still a little bit of a difference here that we're going to have to work out. But Belshazzar is a real guy. I want you to think about the use of the word father. Many times in Scripture, that's not necessarily intended to mean the direct father, as in one generation away from a person. In fact, it's used this way in 2 Samuel 9 and verse 7 to mean a grandfather. You remember the story where David's trying to find some of Saul's, or really of Jonathan's, but Saul and Jonathan's descendants, and he finds Jonathan's son, Mephibosheth, and he's trying to show kindness to Mephibosheth. And what he says to Mephibosheth, he says, "Fear not, for I will surely show thee kindness for Jonathan, thy father's sake, and will restore thee all the land of Saul, thy father." Now, Saul wasn't his father, he was his grandfather. But that word father there is used to denote lineage. We see in Matthew chapter 1, Jesus, or Joseph, really through Jesus, through Joseph, I guess, is called the son of David. It's called the son of Abraham. Well, he's not really their son, but he's in that lineage. So that's the way that it's used there. So could it be possible that it's saying Belshazzar is in the lineage of Nebuchadnezzar, while Nabonidus might actually be his father? Maybe Nebuchadnezzar is a grandfather, perhaps. Jeremiah 27 and verse 7 kind of confirms that this might be the case, because this scripture says, "All the nations shall serve him," Nebuchadnezzar, "his son." We saw the next king after Nebuchadnezzar was Nebuchadnezzar's son, "and his grandson, until the time of his own land comes, then many nations and great kings shall make him their slave." So Jeremiah actually prophesies that Nebuchadnezzar, Nebuchadnezzar's son, and Nebuchadnezzar's grandson would all rule Babylon before it fell. So is it possible that Belshazzar is the grandson of Nebuchadnezzar? Well, there's enough evidence that that's the case that Easton's Bible Dictionary says he was the son of Nabonidus by Nitocris, who was the daughter of Nebuchadnezzar and a widow of Nergal Sharazir. Okay, you say, well, that's a Bible Dictionary. It might be a little biased. But the evidence is strong enough that even the Encyclopedia Britannica says the Babylonian inscriptions indicate that he was, in fact, the eldest son of Nabonidus, who was king of Babylon from 555 to 539, and of Nitocris, who was perhaps a daughter of Nebuchadnezzar. So interestingly, we have Belshazzar, that Daniel 5 records as the last Babylonian king, though history says Nabonidus was the last king. The Nabonidus cylinder says Belshazzar was Nabonidus' son, and there's evidence to say that he was also the grandson of Nebuchadnezzar through his mom, which would fulfill the prophecy in Jeremiah that Nebuchadnezzar, his son, and his grandson would all rule before Babylon was overthrown. Okay, that's fascinating, but was he a king? Because Daniel 5 called him the king of Babylon. And he's not the king, he's the son of Nabonidus the king. Well, except that's where the Nabonidus Chronicle comes in. A line off of this says, "When the third year was about to begin, he," talking about Nabonidus, "entrusted the army to his oldest son, his firstborn. The troops in the country he ordered under his command. He let everything go, entrusted the kingship to him, and himself he started out for a long journey." So in this chronicle that's chronicling the life of Nabonidus, it says at some point in there, Nabonidus decided that he was going to leave and take off on a journey. And when he did that, he entrusted the kingship to his oldest son. Well, who did Nabonidus himself say was his oldest son? Belshazzar, that Daniel chapter 5 records as the king of Babylon when Babylon's overthrown. So in fact, Nabonidus had entrusted the kingship. Now, Nabonidus was still technically king, and that's why on the king list, Nabonidus is shown as the last king of Babylon. But Nabonidus was an absent king. The acting king was his son Belshazzar. So in Daniel 5, when Daniel's writing that history of what happened there, he mentions King Belshazzar because Belshazzar was acting king of Babylon during that time frame. This also confirms why in Daniel 5 and verse 16, Belshazzar tells Daniel, if he's able to interpret the handwriting on the wall, that Belshazzar was going to make Daniel the third ruler in the kingdom. Now, why the third? Why not second? Belshazzar is king. Why couldn't he make him second? Because Belshazzar was acting king. The king was Nabonidus. He was absent. The acting king was Belshazzar. And so the only position that he had available to give to Daniel was to be third in the kingdom, which is exactly what the scriptures record. So all of that put together proves the skeptics wrong who looked at Daniel 5 for so many years and said, it's made up, it's wrong. Actually, archaeology proves that it was right all along. Dr. William Albright, who was the foremost authority in Middle Eastern archaeology during his time, said there can be no doubt that archaeology has confirmed the substantial historicity of the Old Testament. And Nelson Gluck, a renowned Jewish archaeologist, said, no archaeological discovery has ever controverted a biblical reference. Now, this is quite different than Mr. Lazar's statement that archaeology has just proven that the Bible is not true. And that's simply false. He's just not right. In fact, no archaeological discovery has ever contradicted or proved wrong something that the Bible stated. I also want to mention some writings from history that I think are important. And specifically, I want to cover two areas. I want to talk about the existence of Jesus. I want to talk about the crucifixion of Jesus for just a few minutes and what we find in historical writings related to these two things. And I think it's important that we do that because there is still, despite the immense evidence that exists, there is still arguments being made by some that Jesus never existed and that Jesus was not a real person. In fact, I sat in a classroom as I was finishing up my degree, and it was a small class, so we're sitting around a conference room table, about eight of us with the professor. And the professor stated that before all of us. He said, there's just not any evidence that Jesus was ever a real guy. Now, I had not done intense study at that time, but I had done a little bit enough to know that guys like Tacitus, the Roman historian, mentioned Jesus. And I brought it up at that time, and I said, well, there's a Roman historian, Tacitus, that talks about Jesus. And he kind of changed the subject and went on. And that was it. And there was no discussion. But these statements are being made, and people hear these statements, and they think, oh, yeah, that's true. There's just no evidence. Fact is that there is. But unfortunately, there's still people that try to show that Jesus never existed. There's a man named David Fitzgerald. In his book, Nailed: The 10 Christian Myths That Show Jesus Never Existed at All. This is from 2010, only 8 years ago. Here's an excerpt from it. He says, doesn't it just make more sense to assume that there was a historical Jesus, even if we're unable to recover the real facts about his life and death? As it turns out, no, the opposite is true. The closer we look at the evidence for Jesus, the less solid evidence we find. And the more we find suspicious silences and curious resemblances to the pagan and Jewish religious ideas and philosophies that preceded Christianity. And when you begin to parse out the origins of this tradition or that teaching from their various sources, the sweater begins unraveling quickly until it becomes very difficult to buy that there ever was or even could have been any historical figure at the center. And so here's a writer putting out a book that says, once you start pulling at the threads, the whole thing unravels. And there's just no historical evidence that Jesus ever existed. I just want to show you that that's absolutely false. And I want to show you a few examples of that. Josephus was a Jewish historian from the first century. And in his Antiquities of the Jews, book 18, chapter 3, he says this about Jesus. And remember, all of these that I'm about to share with you are hostile witnesses. These are not pro-Jesus, pro-Christian sources that we're looking at. Josephus was a Jew who didn't believe that Jesus was the Messiah, nor would he have wanted to promote that. But he's a historian, and so he records what happens. He says, at this time there was a wise man who was called Jesus, and his conduct was good, and he was known to be virtuous. And many people from among the Jews and other nations became his disciples. Pilate condemned him to be crucified and to die. And those who had become his disciples did not abandon their loyalty to him. They reported that he had appeared to them 3 days after his crucifixion and that he was alive. Accordingly, they believed that he was the Messiah concerning whom the prophets had recounted wonders. Now remember, Josephus doesn't believe this, but he's reporting the facts as he knows them. He could have said, if there was no evidence, if Jesus really wasn't a real guy, and Josephus lives in the same century that Jesus supposedly did, I think he probably would have known that Jesus didn't really exist and could have just said all of the stuff that the Christians said and the disciples said is not true. But he didn't write that. He said what happened was there was a man by the name of Jesus who was a man with good conduct and lived a good life. He had disciples. He was crucified. His disciples believed that he was the Messiah. All things that we would expect if Jesus really was a real historical figure. We mentioned Tacitus, Cornelius Tacitus, the Roman historian, from 116 AD. He wrote, Christus, from whom the name had its origin, suffered the extreme penalty during the reign of Tiberius at the hands of one of our procurators, Pontius Pilatus, and a most mischievous superstition thus checked for the moment again broke out not only in Judea, the first source of the evil, but even in Rome, where all things hideous and shameful from every part of the world find their center and become popular. Now, I want you to notice a couple of things from this. First off, he uses Christ's name, says Christus. He talks about him suffering the extreme penalty. That's referencing crucifixion there at the hands of Pontius Pilatus, Pontius Pilate, as we would know him. And a most mischievous superstition. Christianity was known by the Roman historian Tacitus as a mischievous superstition. And though it was checked for the moment, it broke out in Judea. And then it found its way to Rome. Now, isn't that exactly what the New Testament records happens in the early church? They started there in Jerusalem. They spread throughout all Judea. And eventually we see where the church even ended up in Rome. And so here you've got a Roman historian who talks about that, Christianity even reaching Rome. Oh, and might make mention that he compares or lumps Christianity in with all the other hideous and shameful things from every part of the world that find their way to Rome. Maribar Serapion was a Roman philosopher from 73 to 200 AD, somewhere in that time frame. He was writing a letter to his son, and he uses Jesus as an illustration to make a point to his son in this letter. And so he's not a historian dealing with the facts of what happened. He's simply using something that was known from history as an illustration in this letter. He says, "What advantage did the Jews gain from executing their wise king? It was just after that their kingdom was abolished. God justly avenged these three men. The Athenians died of hunger, the Samians were overwhelmed by the sea, and the Jews, desolate and driven from their own kingdom, live in complete dispersion. But Socrates is not dead because of Plato, neither is Pythagoras because of the statue of Juno, nor is the wise king because of the new law he laid down." And so he uses Jesus as an example with Socrates and with Pythagoras to illustrate a point. But I want to just notice within that a couple of things. He talks about the wise king being executed, common knowledge, Jesus was executed, and also talks about a new law that Jesus had laid down. What do you think that new law was? I think it's the new law we find in the New Testament. I think it's Christianity, the spreading of the church. And so here we have just this kind of offhand reference to a real historical fact. This man by the name of, or known as Pliny the Younger, he was a Roman governor from 111 to 113 AD, so about 80 years or so after Jesus would have died on the cross. He was writing a letter to Emperor Trajan asking him how to handle Christians. Now, at this point, Christians had been being persecuted, had been being put to death. They had become a problem as far as Rome was concerned. And so he's asking for advice from the emperor about how to handle these Christians. He says, "For who can better give guidance to my hesitation or inform my ignorance? I have never participated in the trials of Christians." And then he describes them. He says, "They were accustomed to meet on a fixed day before dawn and sing responsively a hymn to Christ as to a God." Now he's describing the church. He's describing Christians. He says they were accustomed to meet on a fixed day. Any guesses on what that fixed day was? And he says they met before dawn. Now, that's pretty early. We don't meet before dawn today, but evidently they met before dawn. On a fixed day, they sang responsively a hymn. They were singing to Christ as to a God. He mentions Christ and mentions that they reverenced him or considered him their God. And so he goes on, though, that's not it. He says, "For the matter seems to me to warrant consulting you, especially because of the number involved." So here you've got Pliny the Younger writing the Roman emperor and saying, because of the number, there's a bunch of them now. They're a problem. I've never participated in their trials, so I need you to tell me what I'm supposed to do, how to handle them. He says, "For the contagion of this superstition has spread not only to the cities, but also to the villages and the farms." It's a huge problem. It's contagious. It's contagious. It's a superstition. We can't let it spread anymore. It's not only in the cities, but in the villages and the farms. And so just like the New Testament paints the spreading of the church, with people obeying the gospel, with people being a part of that, so history records as well that Christianity did just that. Lucian of Samosata. He was a satirist and writer from about 120 to 180 AD. He wrote the book, The Passing Peregrinus. And so he's making fun of Christians and Christianity. But in making fun of them, he's also acknowledging that certain things about them are true. He says, "The Christians worship a man to this day, the distinguished personage who introduced this new cult and was crucified on that account." So he says, even today, between 120 and 180 AD, he says, "The Christians are worshiping this crucified guy." He says, "You see, these misguided creatures start with the general conviction that they are immortal for all time, which explains their contempt for death and self-devotion." So he's making fun, but recognize a couple of things. He says they believe that they're immortal for all time. What do we call that? We don't generally use that term. Sometimes we might, but we use eternity, or that we have eternal life. That's how generally we as Christians phrase that. But he says they believe they're immortal for all time. Explains their contempt for death and self-devotion. When Christians were persecuted and put to death and didn't falter in their faith, that was seen as strange to people because they thought, how in the world can you believe such silliness that you're immortal for all time? But Christians believed it. And so they were willing to go to their deaths. He says their lawgiver taught that they are all brothers from the moment that they are converted and deny the gods of Greece and worship the crucified sage and live after his laws. All this they take on faith. You know, it's not really a bad description of what Christianity is. We're brothers. We're brothers in Christ. We deny other gods. We worship Jesus crucified. We live after the laws of Jesus. We take it on faith. It's a pretty good description from coming from a hostile witness. Now, if Jesus never existed, if he wasn't a real person, why would so many of these ancient writers have talked about him as a real person and have mentioned his followers who believed he was a real person and followed his laws? See, the historical record says Jesus did exist. If you want to believe otherwise, you're going against what history says, because history records Jesus as being very, very real. I also want to talk a little bit about his crucifixion, though, because an extraordinary claim is made by the scriptures at the time of Jesus' death. And I want to read out of Matthew 27, starting in verse 45. It says, "Now from the sixth hour there was darkness over all the land unto the ninth hour. And about the ninth hour, Jesus cried with a loud voice, saying, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, that is to say, my God, why hast thou forsaken me?" Verse 50 says, "Jesus, when he had cried again with a loud voice, yielded up the ghost. And behold, the veil of the temple was rent in twain from the top to the bottom, and the earth did quake, and the rocks rent." Now, the story the New Testament tells about the day that Jesus was crucified, which crucifixion is verified through history, through historical accounts, says from the sixth to the ninth hour, that would have been from noon to three in the middle of the day, there was darkness over all the land. So for 3 hours, there's darkness. Also says the earth was quaking. There were earthquakes that happened. Rocks were being rent. Rocks were tearing apart. Buildings probably were being toppled and coming apart. All of this happened at the time in which Jesus was crucified. Now that sounds pretty supernatural. That's a supernatural-ish claim, right? So if it was supernatural, and maybe the writer, you know, Matthew here, he's just adding some things in there to make the crucifixion of Jesus seem more powerful. You know, it's really fake. That stuff didn't happen. Because that'd be pretty amazing if it did. But if it didn't really happen, then history shouldn't have any record of it, right? Because that's a supernatural claim. And if the darkness didn't occur for 3 hours, and there weren't earthquakes at just at that moment, and all of that, then history should at least be silent on the subject. But it's not. Thallus was a first century Greek historian who covered Middle Eastern history from the 12th century BC to the 1st century AD. Now, his actual original work has been lost, but we have record of his writings through some other writings, such as Julius Africanus from 221 AD. Now, Julius Africanus writes this: "On the whole world there pressed a most fearful darkness, and the rocks were rent by an earthquake, and many places in Judea and other districts were thrown down." Now he's going to reference the first century Greek historian Thallus. He says, "This darkness, Thallus, in the 263 third book of his history, calls, as appears to me without reason, an eclipse of the sun." So here you've got a first century Greek historian who's saying on the day that Jesus crucified, or was crucified, there is an eclipse of the sun. You know, that's kind of the same thing we talked in part two, you know, when the Jews said about the empty tomb, well, his disciples stole the body. Well, that's like saying we acknowledge that it's empty, but we have a reason for it. Thallus is acknowledging that there was darkness. He was acknowledging at the time Jesus crucified, there was a darkness, but he says, I can explain how. It was a solar eclipse. That's what caused the darkness. But in that excuse, he's basically saying the darkness happened, okay, just as the Bible records. But he's not the only one. Phlegon of Tralles was a Greek writer who lived in the 2nd century AD. He wrote Olympiads, a historical series of 16 books. He says, "In the fourth year, however, Olympiad 202, an eclipse of the sun happened, greater and more excellent than any that had happened before it. At the sixth hour, day turned into dark night, so that the stars were seen in the sky, and an earthquake in Bithynia toppled many buildings of the city of Nicaea." So here you've got a historian, a Greek historian, again, another hostile witness, not a believer in God, not a Christian, who's saying, well, yeah, there was a darkness that happened, but it was an eclipse. Now, it was a greater eclipse than we've ever seen before, but it was an eclipse of the sun. But then he also says there was an earthquake, and buildings were toppling over and falling over. So he's acknowledging that not only was there a darkness, but there were also earthquakes. There were also rocks being rent. Sounds just like the story that's told in Scripture. And here's a hostile witness saying, yeah, these things are true. He doesn't give an explanation for this. It just so happens that an eclipse of the sun happens at the same time there's an earthquake and topples some buildings over. That's it. It's all a coincidence. Tertullian, a second century Christian apologist, challenged his non-Christian adversaries with these words. Now Tertullian, who's a Christian apologist, says at the moment of Christ's death, the light departed from the sun and the land was darkened at noonday. Okay, that's great, but you're a Christian, Tertullian, so we're trying to look for unbiased sources. But then Tertullian says this, which wonder is related in your own annals and is preserved in your archives to this day? So the non-Christian people that Tertullian is trying to talk to about Christ and about the darkness, he's telling them about the day Christ was crucified. He's telling them about the darkness that occurs, and he says, which is recorded in your own histories. You know what that tells me? It wasn't just Christians. It wasn't just Jews. It wasn't just... This happened. Everybody recorded it. It was in everybody's history. Tertullian is going, don't trust me. Look in your own history books. This happened. There was a darkness. And so we've got multiple authors that are saying the darkness happened, earthquakes happened, just as the New Testament said was the case. So let's ask the question, could it have been a solar eclipse? That's the excuse these writers give. It's a solar eclipse. Well, we know when Jesus was crucified was at the preparation of the Passover. It was actually the eve of the Passover. John 19, 14, 15 talks about that. The Babylonian Talmud, which is that Jewish collection of writings, says on the eve of the Passover, Yeshua or Jesus was hanged. So we know the time frame was around that Jewish celebration of Passover, the eve of the Passover. Well, when did the eve of the Passover, when did the Passover happen? Well, Passover is celebrated for 7 or 8 days, depending on your branch of Judaism, starting on the night of a full moon in April. Now, Passover, the celebration of the Passover, always starts on a full moon. Now, if you remember your astronomy a little bit, you may remember that there are certain phases of the moons, and that full moon phase, it's actually quite impossible to have a solar eclipse because the moon does not come between the earth and the sun when it's at new moon, or when it's at full moon, rather, phase. So at the time in which Jesus was crucified, we're 2 weeks away from it even being possible to be a solar eclipse. It's the wrong place, wrong phase. Now, 2 weeks later, it would be the new moon phase where the moon passes between the sun and the earth, and then maybe it could have been a solar eclipse, but we're at the wrong time. Other interesting point to note is that NASA says that the solar eclipse can last at its longest 7 minutes. 7 minutes. This was a darkness that lasted 3 hours. So though those early writers were trying to say, okay, the darkness happened, but it's a solar eclipse, the moon's in the wrong place, and solar eclipses don't last 3 hours. Now, that's why one of them said it was the greatest and most magnificent eclipse we've ever seen. The fact of the matter is, it couldn't have been a solar eclipse. So what was it? Well, no one knows, because no other natural phenomenon fits it. People might say it's a lunar eclipse, blood moon. The problem with that is that doesn't happen between noon and 3 o'clock. And the hostile witnesses also verified at that sixth hour, that's when that happened. People say, well, maybe it was atmospheric dust, you know, got in the way of the sun. We can come up with all sorts of theories and suppositions as to what happened. But throughout this presentation and this series, I hope you've seen that in order to take God out of the equation, we have to have so much stuff just happen to go just right. Was it atmospheric dust? Or is there another explanation? And to further that point, Julius Africanus says this, Phlegon records that in the time of Tiberius Caesar at full moon, there was a full eclipse of the sun from the sixth hour to the ninth, manifestly that one of which we speak. But what has an eclipse in common with an earthquake? The rending of rocks, the resurrection of the dead, and so great a perturbation throughout the universe. Now, of course, the Bible records the resurrection of the dead, but those other things, those historical writers, those hostile witnesses recorded as well, the earthquakes, the rocks breaking, the buildings toppling over. And his point is this, even if you want to say it's a solar eclipse or atmospheric dust or whatever other natural phenomenon you want to throw on there to try to explain it away, what in the world does that have to do with an earthquake and with rocks being torn apart and buildings coming down? Do you believe that? Or do you believe that there's another explanation? I'm going to tell you what I believe the explanation is, and I believe that it can be found at least partly out of Luke chapter 19, 37 through 40. It says, as he was drawing near, talking about Jesus, already on the way down the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of his disciples began to rejoice and praise God with a loud voice for all the mighty works that they had seen, saying, blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord, peace in heaven and glory in the highest. And some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to him, teacher, rebuke your disciples. He answered, I tell you, if these were silent, the very stones would cry out. You know, Jesus mentions here that creation praises the Creator. And that if my disciples weren't praising me, the very stones on the ground would cry out in praise to me. John says in his gospel, all things were created by him, and through him was not anything made that was made. All of the creation was created through Jesus Christ, and creation recognizes the Creator. David said, the heavens declare the glory of God. Everything that's been created praises him. And so what would that creation do at the moment when its creator bears the sins of the whole world and is crucified in a horrific, terrible death? What do you think creation might do? Do you think where ordinarily creation might cry out and praise him, that it might cry out in anguish at the moment of his death? So that the earth quaked and the sun stopped shining for 3 hours and buildings toppled over and the veil of the temple split and the dead were raised again. And all of these things happened simultaneously, all at one moment. History confirms these things. What caused it? Atmospheric dust? Or was it creation crying out at the death of its creator? I believe that it's a supernatural occurrence because no natural phenomenon fits the description. And if it's a supernatural occurrence, then that tells me that the supernatural is real. And if the supernatural is real, God must be real. If God is real, then his word, the Bible, must be true. And those things written, the stories that we have about David, about the Israelites, about Belshazzar, about Jesus, and about this darkness and earthquakes and rocks rending and breaking apart and the veil of the temple being torn, all of these things are true and they're real. It's not made up stories. It's not fiction. It's history. It happened. Encyclopedia Britannica says these independent accounts prove that in ancient times, even the opponents of Christianity never doubted the historicity of Jesus. Nobody did that. Don't let anybody convince you today that Jesus didn't exist, because you're on the wrong side of history if that's the case. John 1 verse 14 says, and the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory. The glory is of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. I believe that Jesus was real. I believe God sent him down to this earth. I believe that what he did on that cross and the reason creation cried out so strongly is because Jesus made the ultimate sacrifice. The Creator died for the created so that our sins could be washed away. What do you believe? What does the evidence show you? What does history tell you? What does archaeology tell you? Will you let it speak truth to you? Will you listen to what it has to say?